water you turned into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. None like you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power. Our God.
So if you would stand and welcome Argel Smith. So
yes.
I'm going to pray over Argel. Last week I finished the book of Acts. He's going to finish all the other books this morning. So, Father, we thank you for Argel. And Father, again, we just ask for your anointing to come upon him. Father, he has studied, he has prepared, but he wants to be led totally by the Spirit today. So, Holy Spirit, come and anoint your servant to speak the words of truth that we need to hear today. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. Today I'm going to be preaching out of John chapter 2, so if you've got your Bibles, you can go ahead and open up to that verse, and you might see a John theme lately that I've been preaching out. That's because I'm leading the soldiers in my battalion through the gospel according to John, and this just happens to be where we are in our teaching, and so next weekend I'm going to just send this recording to the soldiers for the virtual service that can't be in our service, in live service, so that's why I'm preaching on this passage. But, you know, this happens to also be one of my very favorite passages of Scripture, that and a few others. But this is one of my top 10 right here that I'm going to be preaching on today. And it's the wedding at Cana. So in John chapter 2, it begins with verse 1. It says, "The next day there was a wedding celebration in the village of Cana in Galilee." You know, believe it or not, I spent probably the most amount of time studying this verse in my preparation for this sermon today, believe it or not. It's just, why would I spend so much time on this verse? Well, my translation does a really poor job. I love my translation, the New Living Translation, but they really dropped the ball on this one, and it says, "The next day there was a wedding celebration in the village of Cana in Galilee." A lot of your translations will say, after 3 days or 3 days later, there was a wedding in Cana. I think all the translations say that. So I spent a lot of time in the Greek trying to figure out why John would write this here. Because none of the authors of the Gospels wrote in chronological order. John writes in theological order. He takes the stories of Jesus and he lumps them together for theological purposes. And this is one of the only times he writes on the third day. But on some other times, the translators say on the next day. You can see that in 1:29. You can also see that in 1:35, the following day. You can translate it at a few different ways in the Greek. But here John says on the third day. And I got to looking at the Greek, and you can do a lot of interesting things with Greek syntax. You can make the Greek say a lot of different things. And I believe that a more fitting translation would be, on the third day of a wedding in Cana in Galilee, on the third day of a wedding in Cana in Galilee. Well, why do I say that? Well, does something significant happen within Christianity on the third day? I think it does. And what John is trying to do is he's trying to group these two teachings from 2:1 to 2:12, the wedding. He's trying to group this with Jesus clears the temple, which it comes next after this. Now, everybody knows that if you read Matthew, Mark, or Luke, the cleansing of the temple comes where? In the end. But John puts it here at the beginning. And why does he do that? Well, if you look at the very end of that account, Jesus says something very significant to the religious leaders. In verse 19, he says, "All right," Jesus replied, "destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." In 3 days, I will raise it up. And so John is intentionally lumping the story of the wedding in Cana with Jesus cleansing the temple. These two stories go together. But I'm just going to focus on this wedding today. And Jesus says, on the third day, or John says, on the third day of a wedding in Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there. Jesus' mother, Mary, was there at this wedding. Now, weddings in the ancient Jewish culture were huge events. Huge. It's like one of the most important celebrations that you can go to in ancient Jewish culture, and they lasted a week. They lasted 7 days. Some commentators said on the third day was a significant on what day of the week wedding would take place, but that's not probably accurate either, because virgins got married on the fourth day of the week, widows got married on the fifth day of the week. So nobody gets married on the third day of the week. So my translation is, this is something that significant that happens on the third day of the wedding. On the third day of the wedding, something important happens. Verse 2. And Jesus and his disciples were also invited to the celebration. It's interesting that this story comes right after Jesus calls his first disciples. If you followed along in the gospel according to John, we just spent a lot of time on the first disciples and how Jesus called them. And now it says he's with the disciples at this celebration. And in verse 3, probably the most important verse in this, the wine supply ran out during the festivities. The wine ran out. Now, that's a big deal. I know that wine is a little bit of a taboo in American culture, but let me just say, wine was not a taboo in the ancient Jewish culture. Everybody drank wine. But during the wedding, it would have ruined the celebration if on the third day the wine had run out. The wedding would have been ruined. The wedding would have been just, the party would be over if the wine ran out. And somebody dropped the ball, because wine was not supposed to run out. Wine was supposed to last the entire 7 days. We had 4 more days of the wedding. If it's already ran out by the third day, something seriously wrong happened in the planning of this wedding. Something has gone very wrong. And so it says, so Jesus' mother told him, to Jesus, they have no more wine, Jesus. They have no more wine. We've run out of wine. She's probably in a panic. They ran out of wine. They don't have any more wine. Mary must have known who this couple was that was getting married in Canaan. Small area. Everybody knew everybody. So she comes to Jesus because obviously she knows that Jesus can do something about this. Obviously, she has seen Jesus do something extraordinary in the past. Probably, he's probably been doing miracles throughout his whole life, is my argument. Some people say that this is the first recorded miracle of Jesus, or this is Jesus' first miracle. Get that out of your mind. This is not Jesus' first miracle. I can guarantee you, and we will see why I argue that this is not Jesus' first miracle. Jesus has been doing miracles all along. This may be the first public miracle, but this is not Jesus' first miracle. So, he says that cuss word again. I'm not allowed to say, but for the sake of church, I will say the cuss word. Woman. Now, today that's a curse word. You don't address anybody as woman, but in the ancient Near East, this was a sign of endearment. He was talking dearly. And so my translation adds the dear woman to the front of it, but it just says woman in the Greek. But this was a term of endearment in the first century. He says, that's not our problem. What do you want me to do about it? That has nothing to do with us. That has nothing to do with me. What do you want me to do about it? Right? And then he says something important. My hour has not yet come. Now, a little bit of review. The hour of Jesus. The first half of the book of John focuses on the book of signs. Signs that Jesus did that proves and points to the fact that he is the Messiah, the Son of the living God, the Lamb of God who comes to take away the sins of the world. The second half of the book of John is the book of glory, where Jesus enters into his glory, into the passion, onto the cross. And throughout the first half of the book of John, he says, "My hour has not come." This is a phrase that is repeated throughout the first half of the book of John, when he repeatedly says, "My hour has not come." Now, his hour is not a literal 60 minutes. His hour is his passion. So until we get to chapter 12, verse, I think it's 23. Oh, sorry. No, yes, 23. 12:23, Jesus replied, "Now is the hour." Or, "Now the hour has come for the Son of Man to enter into his glory." Now is the hour for the Son of Man to enter into his glory. In chapter 12 there. So from that point on, Jesus begins his passion. He begins his voluntary road to the cross, where he becomes the Lamb of God to take away the sins of the world. Up until this point, his hour has not come. But in chapter 12, his hour will arrive. And then finally, his last words as he's dying on the cross is, "It is finished," in the book of John. And what is finished? His hour. His hour is done. And he looks at his mom and he says, "My hour is not yet come." And what's he trying to say to his mother, who he's talking to endearly at this point? He's trying to say, "Mom, if I do this, I'm going to be starting on the road to the path of the cross. That's where it's going to lead me, Mom. Do you really want me to change this, to do something about this situation? Is that really what you want?" And that's what he's asking of her. And then his mother turned to the servants and told them, "Do whatever he tells you. Do whatever he tells you." She doesn't really address what he just says, because I don't think she wants to address that. And I looked up this word, because I like to look up the word servant in English, because our translators never translate this correctly. But this time they did. Usually the word is doulos. And I talk about, you know, doulos means slave, that we are slaves of God. The apostles referred to themselves over and over, "I am a slave of Christ." And in the Old Testament prophets said over and over, "I am a slave of God." And we are voluntary slaves of God. We have given our lives over to the lordship, the mastery of Jesus Christ as Christians. But in this text, it doesn't say doulos. It says diakonos. The mother told the deacons, "Do whatever he tells you." Now, I want to stop here and say that if you haven't figured it out by now, Jesus always taught in parables. But we have an author here who often writes symbolically and metaphorically. John, I mean, hello, the book of Revelation. Have you guys read that? John is using some symbolic and allegorical and metaphorical language here to describe what's going on. Jesus is about ready to begin his ministry here in a very public way, and she turns to the deacons and says, "Do whatever he tells you to do." And so in this story, if you're a believer, I want to say that you are one of these deacons who is serving Jesus Christ, doing what he tells you to do. As Christians, we are to obey the Lord, right? And then, verse 6, standing nearby were six stone water jars used for Jewish ceremonial washing. Now, these things are huge. They can hold at least 120 gallons of water. Now, what these jars were for is you would go and you would get the ceremonial water for the washing, and then you would take these jars and you would fill up what we would call a baptismal, the washing, the basin, and you would take these jars and you would fill up that tub of water. That's how much water we're talking about, 120 gallons of water used for ceremonial washing. Now, in the book of John, we have seen in the past that water often represents the Holy Spirit. And in this case, it is an abundant amount of water. It is more than enough water. Each could hold 20 to 30 gallons. That's a lot of water. That's 120 gallons. More than enough of whatever Jesus is about to do, I can guarantee you. Jesus told the servants, fill the jars with water. Now, let me just say, Jesus only says four sentences in this entire passage. Four sentences. We've already seen three of them now. Dear woman, that's not our problem. My time has not yet come. Fill the jars with water. This is Jesus' third sentence. We got one more after this. Jesus doesn't say a whole lot in this passage. When the jars had been filled, he said, now dip some out and take it to the master of ceremonies. So, in a parable, who do you think the master of the wedding ceremony is? God the Father. Take some of this out and go give it to the Father. Right? Who's the bride? We are. Who's the bridegroom? Jesus. Okay, I got that in your mind now. So the deacons followed his instructions. The deacons did what they were supposed to do. They obeyed Jesus. When the master of the ceremonies tasted the water, that was now wine, not knowing where it had come from. And now, you know, you heard of the Creepy Joe thing where he whispers into the microphone? That's what John does a lot in the book of John. Though, of course, the servants knew. He called the bridegroom over. So the deacons take some of this water to the master of ceremonies, the one who's supposed to be responsible for making sure the wedding goes down accordingly to plan. And who would have bore some responsibility if it had not? They take it to him, and now it has become wine, indicating that the 120 gallons of water is now wine. An abundant amount of wine. Can you imagine 120 gallons of water? That's going to last more than the 4 days needed to get through this wedding ceremony, right? And he says, a host always serves the best wine first. You're supposed to serve the top shelf wine, the wine that has not been mixed with water first. The wine that has not been diluted. You're supposed to serve that first at the wedding. They're supposed to get the best experience first. Then, this is my translation, when everyone is a little bit tipsy, when everyone has had a lot to drink of the best wine, he brings out the less expensive wine. That's this translation saying that. You bring out the wine that has water added to it. So you serve the best wine first, and then as the celebration goes on, you add a little bit of water and a little bit more water. You got to keep this, and by the last day of the wedding, that wine is diluted, very diluted. But you serve the best first. And once everybody has had a lot to drink, then you add the water. Like I said, It wasn't such a big deal drinking in the Jewish culture. What was a big deal was drunkenness. You don't get drunk in the Jewish culture, but drinking in and of itself was not a big deal. Like we have made it. Paul calls it a diaphora. It's a diaphora issue, indifferent issue. It's indifferent. It's up to the person of whether what they believe on the issue. It's a diaphora, indifferent. But according to this wedding ceremony, it wasn't very indifferent. They all had a little bit to drink because it ran out by the third day. They must have been drinking a little bit too much. Now, let me just add in here that the wine ran out on the third day. Whoever was responsible for making sure that this party had enough wine dropped the ball. And I would argue that that represents all of us. We don't have enough to carry us to the end of the wedding ceremony. And our quality is not that good anyway. The master of the ceremony says, you are supposed to bring out the good first, indicating that whatever he tasted before wasn't that good. It wasn't that good. And there wasn't enough. That represents our works before we come to the Lord. It's not that good. And it's not enough. It's not enough to get you where you need to go. Right? Where was I? Then when everyone has a lot to drink, he brings out the less expensive wine. But you have kept the best until now. You have kept the best. Jesus turned the water into wine. Not only did he elevate the quantity of the wine that existed at this party to an abundant amount, more than anybody could possibly have imagined to drink, but he raised up the quality of the wine to something far superior that was even superior to the best wine that was served in the beginning. Because he is the Lamb of God who comes to take away the sins of the world, the wine that Jesus offers on our behalf for our wedding ceremony is far superior to the wine that we have to offer ourselves. And so again, we see this exchange being made. In the Samaritan woman where I preached a few weeks ago, we saw the exchange of the water of deception being traded for the living water, the Holy Spirit. This week we see the exchange of your insufficient, poor quality wine works being traded for the perfect wine, the blood of Christ, in this passage. This miraculous sign. In the book of John, he really never just calls what Jesus did miracles. He calls them signs. The point of a sign is to indicate where something or what something is. In this case, there's big neon lights pointing directly to Jesus saying, Messiah, Messiah, Son of God, Lamb of God who comes to take away the sins of the world. That's what this big sign is saying. These signs are intended to show the Jewish audience that Jesus really is the Messiah, the Son of God, who has come to take away our sins. This miraculous sign at Cana in Galilee was the first time Jesus revealed his glory. The first time, not the first time that Jesus did a miracle, get that out of your mind. This is not the first time Jesus did a miracle. And in fact, in a lot of times in the book of Mark, Jesus does a miracle, and he says, shh, don't tell anybody. Don't tell. And what they do, they go run and tell. But Jesus always says, don't tell anybody. Don't tell anybody. Why? Because his hour has not come. But this is the first time he has revealed his glory, what he has come to do. His mission is to offer himself up to the Father as a perfect, spotless sacrifice for our sins. A sufficient sacrifice that is good and perfect and high quality. the best. There can be no higher. That's what Jesus came to do for us. So let me just say this. If you're listening, maybe some of you who are listening here, or some of you listening online, maybe you do not know who Jesus Christ is. Maybe you do not have a relation with Jesus Christ. You can have a relationship with Jesus Christ today. You can come to the Father today through the Holy Spirit. God is just one prayer away. Just one prayer away. All you got to do is repent, turn away from your sin, turn your back on sin, turn back to the Father, confess your sin to Him, claim the blood of Jesus Christ upon your life to cover your sins, and ask for forgiveness. And Jesus will forgive you, and the Father will forgive you through that sacrifice. Now, if you are a believer, listen up. It ends this way. And the disciples believed in Him. Now, the disciples already believed in Him. The disciples had already believed in Him. And this is a theme we see throughout John. We see a couple of themes playing out. We see the theme of the hour. We've seen the theme of Jesus providing something greater. We've already talked about that. Jesus is greater than John the Baptist. Jesus is greater than the well of Jacob's well. Jesus offers the greatest sacrifice. He offers the best wine. He's the greatest. That's the second theme. The third theme is believe. The gospel according to John uses the word believe about 96 times. And every time it's used, it is a verb. It is something that is active. You must act on your belief in the gospel according to John. Now, we can talk about faith all day long in the letters of Paul. John doesn't use the word faith. He uses the word to believe. Believe is important. And believe is an active verb. Just like the deacons had to obey Jesus, through our belief, we obey Jesus. Now, they had already believed, but throughout John, we're going to see throughout many times in John, and then they believed. And then they believed. And then they believed. In fact, at one point it says, I believe, Lord, but help my unbelief. I believe, Lord, but help my unbelief. And so we are like that too as children of the Lord. We believe, Lord, help our unbelief. And so these signs not only help people come to the Lord, point to Jesus being the Messiah, but it also helps our faith in Jesus. It helps us to believe so that we can carry out the work that God asked us to carry out, because the work that God asked us to carry out is not easy. It's not easy being a Christian. If you're tied up into that wealth, health, prosperity gospel, you're in trouble, because the life of the Christian is hard. It's hard work. I mean, they had to go take this water. They had to take these jugs. They had to fill it with water. They had to carry it back. You know, it's hard work being a Christian. It's hard work obeying Jesus Christ. But because of what Jesus does for us and the witness that we have of Jesus through the Holy Spirit, it helps our belief. It helps us to carry out the work that Jesus called us to do. Dave, I got done early. So those are the two things I want us to take away today. One, believe. Increase your belief. Even if you're a believer, believe more. There's always room for more. Allow the Holy Spirit to continually fill you up. Allow the blood of Jesus to constantly cover up your sins. Return to Him. Repent. If we're believers, we have to return. We have to repent. We have to confess. We have to reapply all the time. I encourage you today, go take communion. The whole symbol of this passage I've been preaching about is what Jesus came to do, and the communion is back there for you. And if you don't know Jesus, turn to him today. Turn to the Father today. Turn to the Holy Spirit today. We can see the whole Trinity in this passage today. Trust in Jesus Christ for your salvation as your Lord and Savior. All right, let me close in prayer. Father God, we just thank you for the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, who is the Lamb of God who comes to take away our sins, Father. The blood of Jesus was sufficient. It was sufficient. It was more than enough. It's more than enough, Father. It's never going to run out. It's never going to end. And Father, we just thank you that the quality of this blood, the sacrifice, he is the spotless lamb, Father. He has no blemish. We thank you for that sacrifice today. Father, we ask for whatever sins are in our lives, Father, we confess that we have fallen in thought, word, and deed, neglect, you name it, Father, we all fall. We just ask, Father, forgive us for our sins. Let that water of the Holy Spirit and the blood of Jesus Christ wash over us. Forgive us, Father. And we thank you, Father, for the life that we have in you. I ask that this message, Father, will increase our faith, will increase our belief, that we may go out and do what Jesus has called us to do. Especially as we just saw in the book of Acts, Father, that each of us are a part of that story. You are writing our stories, Father. And we just thank you in all of these things. In the name of Jesus, amen. Get my water.
Okay, so the phrase, I got done early. Totally unaware of the meaning of that phrase. So thank you for enlightening me. And now I kind of understand what that means. So I did ask Argel to get done early this week so that we could do something else here at the end and not feel rushed. So.